Thank you very much. Please.
Okay, I was told it's been 20 minutes, so I'm going to cut it down because I've got too many slides here, preparing for half an hour. Now, this is a work that we've been doing for some time to think about how do we go beyond just VDC. I mean, how do we think about the science of VDC? How do we arrange the processes that VDC is actually interested in? Right, so Dr. Yeo is one of my colleagues, all right, and he, both of us are working in this area, and we can call ourselves a smart construction group, right, and we are from the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering at the U.S. Now, here we have, this is the outline where I'm going. First of all, to look at the productivity challenge in the AEC industry, and how then shall we tackle this, and then look at probably the agent for transformation. And then the physics of VDC, virtual design and construction. What is the science behind it? And we came up with a framework that we'd like to share with you. Right? And then probably some research examples of how to incorporate this. The productivity challenge, now if you look at this, this is, I put it out at every 5 years. This is the productivity of the various industries in Singapore, right? And there's some, I mean, we can see that the AEC is also performing very badly in many other countries. You always lag behind the manufacturing, banking, retail, and so on. Now, 1991, and that's 1996, this big one is the GDP, right, of the whole Singapore. And then, just look at bubbles just moving around. I just want you to see where you think is the AEC industry, all right? That's 2000, 2006, 2012. You see some of them are just moving ahead of the others. So where do you think the construction industry would be? Yeah, you're not too far away. All right, left bottom. And what happens is that you see that the manufacturing, finance is always moving up there. Transportation, storage here. Now, beside construction, the bubble besides construction is the food and accommodation. And that's where we are. And I do not know whether the experience is the same in other countries, very much almost the same. Right? So we are lagging behind the other industries, and for what reason? So one of the reasons, I mean, if you look into this whole thing, it says that if you look into the transformation in manufacturing, logistics, and retail and banking, there's something that we can learn from them. I think they have in the technology, but they also change the processes as they use the technology. And that's something that's very important. It's not just adopting a technology, like for instance, what we have now is BIM. And just adopt BIM, thinking that it will solve all the yields, but how do we then change our processes in order to be able to exploit this technology? Now, if you look into banking, banking has exploited ICT tremendously. Now, we don't do banking at the bank itself. It's all over. It's on the internet. It's on the mobile. And it's just doing that because they have changed the processes. Now, the same thing, manufacturing is not just a 3D that is there. It's, they have been doing, they have moved towards lean processes. In manufacturing, and that has captured the whole change in the industry. It's twice the productivity has been gained through the use of lean processes. So the disturbing thing is this, no productivity gains hoped for, despite all the rapid advances in technology, CAD, web-based collaboration tools, and large equipment, and so on. And now we have BIM. Now, if we don't know, if we don't exploit this carefully, just continue as we are, we're going to end up again, right? Another fad that comes on and then it fades away, or it's not going to make that dent in this challenge of productivity. The challenge is this: there's inherent waste within the project site. That's key. It is not just the use of technology, but there's inherent waste. There's need for coordination, and so that's why lean construction has to be brought into the picture. Now, highly fragmented both vertically and horizontally, means vertically in the sense of the project life cycle, and horizontally, at any moment in time, you can see that it's very fragmented. There are many parties involved, many players, everyone, the stakeholders, different objectives and so on. How do we bring this together? Right, that's where the challenge is. Right? And then the lack of interoperability to share information causes the silo information repeat and so on. And that's where I think BIM has a potential to be able to lift this. So the agent for transformation, just thinking about it, that is technology, that's BIM, and that's innovative process that must come in, which is the lean process, the challenge, therefore, we can then address the waste, the fragmentation, and the interoperability. And that's where I believe that we have an industry transformation, lean, leading to productivity gains. And I just want to address this whole idea of the physics between the two, right? The science that is, has to be there to govern how the process works with this technology. Now this is the definition of BIM. We can think about it, a virtual construction of a structure that contains intelligent objects, a single source, right, that source of truth that when shared among the project team increases the amount of communication and collaboration. That's what some people define BIM as that. And I would just like to think about it as the intelligence, as the single source, and as the idea of sharing. And that will be able to handle the fragmentation, the interoperability. And the idea here, BIM has the potential to be able to incorporate intelligence into the whole process of the VDC, virtual design and construction. It's because of the ability to be able to compute the components inside BIM itself. So we can say that it's coordinated, computable, it is consistent. Three C's are BIM. Now, in manufacturing, this is what they do. They start out with computer-aided drawings, then move to solid models, and they have gone into product life management. Right? That's where they use it for analysis, manufacturability, modernization, CNC production, supply, whole supply chain is all integrated in this 3D solid model that they have. They have all the information that is there and they integrate the whole process, and enabling analysis to be done at each stage so that objectives of all the clients, of the different project stakeholders, are all can be analyzed and can be decided upon. So that's the whole thing here. Now, can we emulate this? Alright, so I think here we have the similar thing that we can do. And what we have here is computer-aided drawings. We have BIM now, that was in the past year, now we have BIM. And what we need to do is project life management and its VDC, virtual design and construction. Right? And that's been talked about for some time. Okay. And the goal of it, of course, is to be able to virtually do all the construction and the design before we expand resources that are huge, right? In terms of, look at the buildings that have been done just now. It is huge expenditure of time, resource, and money, right? And if we can do all this in the VDC environment, that's where we can capitalize on it. But the whole problem, the whole thing is that, what is the physics of this VDC? Okay. The essential aspects of VDC is this, as a multidisciplinary, right, that's very important, ensures involvement of stakeholders and their requirements are promptly valued and managed. Okay, that's key. It's an integrated environment where the necessary analysis to be implemented is to ensure the project value objectives are achieved and optimized in every stage of the project. Right? And then finally, there are three key elements in BIM that enables this to take place. One is the idea of product, where it's the description of all the components there, right? And then there's the organization, the representation is there, who are the various parties that are involved can be represented. And then there is the process, where it's related design, construction processes also must be represented within this environment. Now, physics of BDC, and that's where I'm trying to think about this, as there are three pillars that will support this framework, and then there is a foundation. Right? And these three pillars are interrelated, that's why I brought these arrows here. The foundation here is link principles. And I'm calling this framework as intelligent project realization, emphasizing the aspect of being able to embed intelligence into the BIM, the BDC process. Right? And I call it project realization, not just the idea of virtual, but really realizing the project itself. So there's information management, right, which is a lubricant of the whole decision process and the whole VDC. There is a process re-engineering that must take place. And then there is the embedded intelligence that I just talked about. Now, there are two additional elements that I think must be incorporated besides the POP, the product organization process. There is these two other additional elements. There's the interdependencies and the constraints that must be there. That's where we make sure that it is project related, constraints are all catered for. And there is the importance of performance model that must be inside this whole process. So I call it IP POP, right? Okay, now the performance model is a representation of the goals and the outcomes of various stakeholders. So we have to have this performance model to address what are the objectives of each stakeholder in that whole project life cycle. It could be green, therefore you have to have a performance model to be able to do that, right? Using the BIM to be able to analyze that, achieving the metrics that's been set out from the onset. So that's the whole idea here. So it's a collaborative apparatus for analysis, evaluation, and even alternative formulation. So this performance model is very key, right, to the success of being able to make alternative formulation of the project. Now the other one is the interdependencies and the constraints, where the parameter interdependencies between stakeholders, processes, and products, supply chain issues, key resource constraints are key bottlenecks in the BDC. Right? And constraints brought about by the project, it is important to the physics because their absence and mismanagement can cause waste. And that's true. Now, otherwise, there will be a big rework loop coming back again to the design. So all these things have to be brought up front, identified, and modeled somehow. So information, as I said, is the lubricant of processes, the performance models, the decisions. That's where the information actually is the one that drives all this. It is needed for making all these decisions and performance evaluation at every stage. So there are two important criteria here in order to be able to implement Lean. One is the model must be fit for intended downstream use. So in this case here, we talk about the level of details that is needed to make sure that the team members at different stages will have that level of detail to make analysis, and it has to be able to do various functions. It must be fit for the function that is needed at even different stages. Right? And the decisions then can be made in a timely manner. Now, if it's wrong sequence, then there will be assumptions made that could lead to some rework. Now, modeling guidelines and standards have to be followed very closely. Now, get model right the first time. That is one of the important principles. Conform the project requirements and intention that is maintained throughout. And that's where don't let defective model propagate down the design process. Because once there's a defective model that goes down, everybody's energy will be concentrated on that model because it's all shared. It's a single source of truth. And if it's all shared, then there are a lot of repetitions if this model has to be changed. Right? So we have to make sure the defective model do not propagate down the design process. project requirements have to be brought up with onset, have to be defined, and this will then define the performance models and the metrics that have to be in place. Now, process is the enabler to integrate the different disciplines and the objectives from a single model. This is the second pillar. Right? There's a need for process re-engineering. You need to move away from mere BIM modeling, visualizing, and transformation. Just mere transformation of the 2D process is not sufficient. Right? So now the process flow design governed by availability of information. We have to evaluate the model further down upstream and stop deficient design from cascading. So we have to think about that. How do we bring the availability of information? We have to think through, and how do we make that the model, the process, can be done at an earlier stage. The metrics we talked about, and the basis for comparing alternate designs and making trade-offs. The metrics will then determine the information required, which will determine the workflow that supports the model performance evaluation. So we're talking about in the fact that they are all very tightly coupled. The overriding principle again is lean. Right? Now, embedded intelligence is what is in key here, is the basis for automation. Enables the early design evaluation for constructability, manufacturability, right? And enables consistently high quality rapid processes. Now the idea here is to augment the embedded design construction knowledge. Series of automated tasks, right? Perform the model and evaluate the model by reference to this knowledge. Design detailing, for instance, right? And then design checks for manufacturing. These are just examples of it. Now, this smart design here is what we have. And this is the traditional, the gray one, and the green is what the building smart people are saying that BIM can do, which is to push the effort up here so that there will be less problem downstream. Now, this is where I'm thinking that the embedded intelligence can help to push this even further up. Because if the intelligence that is needed, right, the knowledge, whether it's tacit, whether it's explicit, can be embedded into the model up front, then all these processes can be evaluated before it gets done. And so this is basically the idea here. The foundation, right, is the lean principle. There are two key sources of waste: rework, over-processing, resulting from unnecessary compliance checks. Now, the potential for automation, these are some of the things, is it painful, tedious, for what follows rules or knowledge, whether explicit or tacit, can be actually expressed in knowledge and we can bring it up front. Right? What involves massive computational effort, right, can also be automated. Now this is the mechanism that we think that could be used to model what we have been talking about. Here we have a MDM, which is actually multiple domain metrics. And we have here the five elements that we the product, organization, there's process here, there's interdependent dependencies, and the performance model, and we have metrics of how they work together. The blue ones will be more like DSM, design structure metrics, and here will be the DMM. Right? And there are various analysis techniques to be able to evaluate these metrics. So the idea here now is that we can look into the processes, model the dependencies, and how they are related in these five elements. We've done a project on just a couple of this to be able to then model this and then evaluate, analyze, and see how we can cluster, we can partition, we can tear up, so that we can then make the process as we want to. This is a table here that try to relate what is needed here in the analysis with the MDM analysis technique. Right? These are all the various key points for the various pillars here, the information management, process re-engineering, and the idea of embedded intelligence, that these are some of the key points that are there, how the analysis can actually correspond to this. Now, these are some research examples, all right, that we've been doing over the years. We have done some of this, and this, for instance, constructability analysis of schedules grouping. So what we have here is that we're putting knowledge into what are needed in construction requirements, and we analyze this from the 3D model so that we can know about space requirements, we can talk about sequence, we can talk about construction requirements that are needed at each stage of the project. And because of that, then we can analyze the schedule, whether it is can be implemented or not. Automatic scheduling with BIM models. So the moment we have a BIM model, we can have a schedule that is automated from there based on construction requirements. We have this optimized fabrication, prefabrication with configuration analysis. I'll show you that later. Design for structure safety, optimization of site utilization, and with intelligent design analyzer. This is the prefabrication configuration that is automated based on the 3D model. So we have a 3D model, and then we can break it up into a library of preferred configurations. And then we can have the modes that are decided based on certain cycle time for each floor. We can then optimize the number of modes needed to be able to push that schedule at the same time. So we use GA, the boost search and so on, isomorphism and algorithms to be able to understand the 3D model and then configure the 3D model in its prefabrication based on the preferred configurations. Right? So it can be any complex configuration, you will be able to map that and come up with the least number of modes. This is quite useful because that from the early design, right, we could then actually come up with a construction process to be able to map this to be the most efficient configuration that is needed to be able to push for site construction. It's intelligent BIM-based DFS, so we looked at this and says, okay, can we get a BIM model and then identify all the construction and operational hazards that could be derived, I mean, that could occur because of the BIM model. We developed a language for that, right? And some of the rules, the agents that are there, we have used agents. Let's say, for instance, we have a gondola, be able to reach the certain elements outside, can it be reached or can even come into the building, we can actually analyze that. We can also analyze gondola, whether it could reach the windows. We have scissor leaf and cherry pickers and so on. All right, so the rules can be extended for constructability concepts so that when we have a BIM model, we can then evaluate whether these things can be constructed even before it is being executed, right? So that the design can change accordingly. Now, this last one here is intelligent design analyzer that we recently completed. The schematic design, then we have a validation, and usually there's multidisciplinary checks at different iterations, and there's a lot of research based on this. Now, one project that we are doing, which is currently doing, I mean, we finished it. It is after they finish the schematic, it will take about 6 weeks to finish that, and then there will be all the checks. And then there's some rework that needs to be done, and the whole 6 weeks is repeated again and again. Right? So the idea here is, can we bring out some of the design checks elements that will be done downstream? Can we bring it upstream through some intelligence? Right? So the organization says, okay, let's just go for the 3x3. And it's 3 most difficult decisions, right? Validation that needs to be done for 3 disciplines. So we work on that, and we come up with a design modeling suite where we can build up very quickly the model, and then we have a Lego fashion type of things that can then check for various various design validation, like distance and so on, and even smoke-free approach, the airflow and so on. And then at the same time, they have structural elements that needs to be checked and some M&E, so that at the end of it, we have a messing model that can then be put into an IFC compliant, make it to IFC ready for detailed design. So this whole process then can be shrunk in terms of time. Instead of 6 weeks, they could actually finish the thing in a relatively short time. At the same time, the design has been checked for the key elements. Right? So this is how we think that it can perform. So in conclusion here, we have the promise of BIM has not been really fully realized at the moment. Right? And therefore, something must be done about it. And I think it's really the change in our process. And how do we then have a framework to be able to come up with that physics for this process change. So VDC to realize full potential for process transformation and dramatic gains in the project performance. But what is that physics? So we came up with this whole idea of Lean Intelligent Project Realization Framework, which added two dimensions to the, so that we have a holistic perspective of VDC, where we have not just the process, but the product, organization, and the process that goes into the project, but also the interdependencies and the performance model. And then there will be three pillars to be able to analyze and replicate for successful implementation. That's where we have the information management, process re-engineering, and embedded intelligence. And we then put all this into a framework, which is the multiple domain metrics, where we can have all these five elements represented. And then based on that table that we talk about, how each of these pillars can then be analyzed and then implemented in a lean way. Right, that's all.